Thank you. Okay, so I mean, what I'm going to talk about is joint work with Ali Shamseddin and Slava Mukanov. It's a very strange fact which occurred during the summer. So if you want, you have two different worlds. I mean, there is a world of geometry. Okay, where you have general relativity and so on, and you think about manifolds, local coordinates, G mu nu's, all this stuff. Okay, so this is the whole world. Okay, and on the other hand, you have this the quantum. Okay, quantum world. And okay, I mean, you know, there are essentially in physics, there are like, if you look carefully at the history of 20th century physics, there are two trends which almost never mix. And they belong to either side. Okay, Heisenberg belongs to this side. And okay, I mean, and there are, of course, attempts to relate the two, but so what I will explain is a kind of a, you know, it's an equation. So the whole topic will be about an equation. Okay, and this equation will be in the quantum world. In other words, you know, okay, one knows since von Neumann, Heisenberg, of course, but since the formalism of quantum mechanics, that the quantum world is kind of born in Hilbert space. So what you have is Hilbert space and operators. And this has a tendency to be a little bit forgotten. I mean, if you want to talk to mathematicians who are doing derived categories and so on, you know, about Hilbert space. I mean, there is a very simple thing to tell them, which is the following, which is that somehow, you know, you have to, if you ask a crowd of mathematicians, what is a variable? Okay, I mean, the normal answers that they will give you, a real variable, okay. The normal answers that they will give you is that a real variable, you have a set X, and you have a map F from X to the real line. Okay, and what you find out if you take this definition is that the definition which doesn't allow compatibility of discrete variables with continuous variables for the following simple reason that if, you know, the variable is discrete, then X will be countable because every value would take, say, only one multiplicity and so on. And if a variable is continuous, then the set X has to be uncountable. So they cannot coexist in the ordinary formalism. Discrete variables cannot coexist with continuous variables. And the beauty of the formalism of quantum mechanics, is that they do coexist. And how do they coexist? They coexist because a real variable in the quantum language is a self-adjoint operator. And self-adjoint operators in a separable Hilbert space, there is only one. And of course, we know very well that you can have self-adjoint operators which have discrete spectrum with eigenvalues with multiplicity one, okay? And they are acting in the same Hilbert space as operators which have continuous spectrum. The only nuance is that they don't commute. Because if they would commute, there would be a simultaneous space, X, on which they would be mapping, which is not the case, so they don't commute. Okay. And what we shall see now is that from an equation which is a purely operator theoretic equation, so it will be an equation in Hilbert space, the geometry will be born. Geometry will be born. And I anticipate a little bit, but I mean, geometry will be born exactly with the standard model, coupled with standard model, in fact, a minimal, asymptotically free extension of the standard model. So that this is what we have achieved. And in order to explain this, I have to go back to long time ago, some long time ago. Okay, I was very struck by the following fact, which is a simple fact. I mean, okay, there was this very simple equation for the circle, for the geometry of the circle. So the geometry of the circle can be defined by a single equation, which is U inverse D commutator U is equal to 1. So if you look at this equation, and U is unitary, so U star is equal to U inverse. Okay. So I could have used U star instead of U inverse here. So what do I mean by that? So what I mean is that this equation, if you look at its irreducible representations, you'll find out they depend on a single parameter. And the reason is the following. For irreducible representations, the reason is that this equation can be written as U inverse du minus d, or is equal to d plus 1. So it says that the spectrum of d is invariant by a shift of 1. And if it's irreducible, there would be nothing else in the spectrum. So the spectrum would be all the form alpha plus z, okay, where alpha is some number that you can take between 0 and 1. So, and it turns out that this alpha is the only invariant, it's the only parameter. And that if you take an irreducible representation, of course, u will be the shift operator on the spectrum. And if you take this equation and you compute the geometry which you obtain, you will find out that the spectrum of U is equal to S1, of course. I mean, it cannot be less than S1. I mean, it cannot be an interval in S1, because you wouldn't have this equation. And moreover, when you compute the distance, so you can compute the distance by computing the distance between two points A and B in the spectrum of U by the formula, which is the supremum of f of a minus f of b, okay, where f is a function that satisfies that d commutator f is the norm less than 1, less or equal to 1, then what you find out is that you find that this is a spectrum, this is a, so it's S1, but with a metric of length 2 pi. Okay, so there was this very easy toy case. Okay, so there was this very easy toy case, and then the question that was coming naturally is, okay, what can we do, for instance, for the two sphere? Okay, now for the two sphere, what I observed a very long time ago is that, in fact, it is simpler to write. To write functions on the two sphere, with values in M2 of C, okay, on S2, than functions on S2. You see? That's a very strange fact. But I mean, one has to be struck by it in order to catch the thing. And what do I mean by that? I mean that if I want to write functions with values in M2 of C, okay, well, of course, I will have the constant matrices, okay? So I will have several constant matrices which will appear, okay? But I will interspace them with something which I will call Y, okay? So Y is like a punctuation, it's like a comma, okay? Okay, but I cannot put two Ys because the rule is that y squared is equal to 1. Okay, so if I would put two y's, I would, it's like if I wouldn't put anything. Okay, and now the fact which you can check that exactly as for functions over the circle, you would take Laurent functions, and polynomials in U and U inverse. If you take arbitrary monomials like this, okay, and you add them, you combine them, then you get the functions on the two sphere with values in 2x2 matrices, okay? And this is incredibly simple because, Y is like punctuation. So the only rule that Y satisfies is Y squared is equal to 1, okay? Now, if you want to be a little more precise, you have to say that when you take the trace of Y with respect to 2x2 matrices, so you average Y on 2x2 matrices, you get 0. And then you get exactly the right thing, okay? Okay, and so after that, a long time ago, okay, I also looked at 4x4 matrices, and then we collaborated with Gianni to find non-commutative examples, and so on and so forth. So the origin of our work with Ali and Slava is to look at, actually, you know, the higher dimensional case, the four-dimensional case. And there is one thing which I didn't tell you about the two sphere, which is what replaces this equation. Because here I told you how you get functions and so on, but I didn't tell you what is the equation which replaces this equation, okay? And it turns out that the equation that replaces this equation is remarkably simple in terms of the y, which is here. And this equation is actually the following. It's that if you take, I will explain the meaning of the formula, but I mean, if you take y, decommutator y, but now you square it, okay? And I put these brackets, I will explain what they mean. And then the equation is that this is equal to gamma. Okay, that this is equal to gamma. What is gamma? Well, okay, behind the scene, in all this discussion, there is a mathematical notion which is playing a fundamental role, but it's behind the scene. And it's better if I explain it now. So there is some, if you want, there is some interplay already existing between geometry and the Hilbert space. And this interplay, in fact, comes from the Atiyah-Singer index theorem and comes from, in fact, an idea of Atiyah, which then was developed by Brown, Douglas, Fillmore, Kasparov, Voiculescu, and many people. And the interplay is the following. The interplay is that when you do geometry, you have algebraic topology, you have cohomology theories, okay? And among these theories, so you have cohomology theories, okay? And among these theories, you have K theory, which was at first invented by Grothendieck in the algebraic setup, but then done in the topological setup, in particular by Atiyah. And when you look at K theory, what you find is that it's a cohomology theory, and it has a dual theory, which is called K-homology. Okay. And this K-homology actually, amazingly, when you look at the space, an ordinary space, so this is ordinary geometry, when you look at an ordinary space M, it turns out that when you want to define what are the K-homology cycles on an ordinary space, they are best encoded by Hilbert space representations. So if you want, there was already this kind of relation between the two, which was given by cohomology cycles, and which tell you that you actually not look at the manifold itself, you look at the sister algebra of continuous functions and M, and then you represent in Hilbert space, and there is a role, not for the operator D that I talked about before, but for its phase. All right. Okay, so I mean, there is this thing which is present. And okay, when one develops the theory, so at first it was developed in a very short paper by Atiyah, in which he called abstract elliptic operators. And then, okay, you know, it took more and more shape in the mathematical language. And of course, the ultimate shape is the Kasparov theory. And in that theory, the gamma has a meaning. But of course, the gamma also has a meaning in physics. So this is what physicists call the chirality operator. And in mathematics, it's a Z2 grading. Okay, so from the point of view of mathematics, it's a Z2 grading. Okay. So the equation, this is the equation for the two sphere. And okay, what was known since a long time was that if you want, when you write down this equation, and you write down 2x2 matrices of functions on the two sphere and so on, provided you define what is this thing. So this thing is a trace. So this thing is a trace with respect to 2x2 matrices. Okay. So what do I mean by that? I mean that as soon as you have an algebra of 2x2 matrices somewhere, Okay, in some other algebra, you can define what is the trace with respect to this algebra of 2x2 matrices. There are many ways to define it. There is the fact that as soon as you have an algebra of 2x2 matrices somewhere, you can write everything in terms of 2x2 matrices, but operator values, I mean, with values in the commutant of the 2x2 matrices. And then the trace is simply the thing which to A11, A12, A21, sorry, A21 and A22 assigns A11 plus A22. But there is a kind of a better way, or if you want, a normalized way of doing it, which is to average the elements according to the 2x2 matrices by conjugating by unitary operators. And then you get, if you average, really, you get a normalized trace. Namely, you have to divide this by 1/2. Okay, so now what was known since quite a time was that if we look at this equation, say, in dimension 2 and so on, then it turns out that any Dirac operator corresponding to a metric, so any for any metric G mu, okay, which has the properties that the total volume, okay, is equal to the volume of the sphere, but okay, let me say the volume is equal to 1, okay, this is the only constraint, then you get a solution of this equation. So what is quite striking is that this equation doesn't fix the metric at all, it only fixes the volume, and it allows you for arbitrary volumes, okay. Moreover, this equation has another very important property, which is that, you know, if I would write conditions on the Dirac operator, and so on, I mean, I would have a hard time to explain why, for instance, okay, the metric is non-degenerate or things like that. Now, this equation is exactly telling you, because that it involves exactly the determinant of the A of the Wirbein. And saying that the determinant of the Wirbein has some value is telling you, which cannot vanish, I mean, it's telling you really that the metric is non-degenerate. Okay, so our starting point in the work with Ali and Slava was to start from this equation. But as I said, you know, in the meantime, we had found with Janis that when we take now not 2x2 matrices, but if you take 4x4 matrices, then there are theta deformed solutions and so on. So we worked with an ansatz, if you want, when for the form of the operator Y. And the ansatz can be described as follows. So let me see. It's very important to remark, before I continue, it's very, very important to remark the similarity between this equation and the Heisenberg commutation relation. And the reason is the following. You see, the reason is that it's like a discrete form of the Heisenberg commutation relation. In the sense, it's like, this is like playing the role of P, okay? And this is like playing the role of Q, except that now, okay, it's not an unbounded operator, it's really on the circle, okay. So what we what we have found by this ansatz, you know, with Ali and Slava, is we have found that there is a first rather natural way to extend this equation, okay, which we call the one-sided equation. You will understand why soon. Okay, and the extension, yes, I think I should proceed in a canonical manner. Yeah. Okay, so what is the ansatz? The ansatz is that you write the same type of equation, but you now write that y is equal to y a gamma a, okay, where the gamma a, okay, are gamma matrices. And what do I mean by that? I mean they fulfill, you know, the Clifford algebra relations. And since we want to have some freedom, okay, what we did, we write this Clifford relation like gamma A, gamma B, you know, the anti-commutator is equal to 2 delta AB, but we put some kappa. And this kappa allows us to consider two cases. I mean, there will be the case of kappa is equal to 1, and the case where kappa is equal to minus 1. Okay, so there are gamma matrices, they fulfill these relations. And then, you know, okay, of course, I mean, if the gammas, they satisfy that they're like the square of gamma square is minus 1, then they have to be skew adjoint. So, I mean, the condition is that gamma A star is equal to kappa gamma A. And the same thing, of course, has to hold for Y. So Y star is equal to kappa Y. Okay, so for instance, if kappa is 1, Y will be self-adjoint. And then the condition which replaces the fact that, you know, which I had written here, is the same. So it would be Y square equals 1 if kappa was equal to 1. In general, it's Y square equals kappa. Okay. So this is the ansatz that we have. Okay. And I mean, the YA commute, so these things commute with the Clifford algebra. So they are, okay, they commute with the gammas, with the gamma A's. Okay? So, of course, I mean, the way you have to think of it is that you have a fixed Hilbert space, you have a fixed Clifford algebra in the Hilbert space, acting in the Hilbert space, and then you combine, you take these combinations. All right. And what is the underlying idea? The underlying idea is incredibly simple. Is that, after all, you know, what Dirac did when he wrote the Dirac operator, which, in fact, Hamilton had already done, because Hamilton had written, you know, d by dx times I plus d by dy times j plus d by dz times k. So, I mean, this type of combination is called the Feynman slash. And when we were working in non-commutative geometry, we were using always the Dirac operator. But now we also have to use the Feynman slash of the coordinates. That's the idea. Okay. So to respect the symmetry between the two. Okay. And then the equation is the same as the one I had written before. Okay. So this is what we call the one-sided equation. So the one-sided equation is the following. The one-sided equation is that if you take this expectation value, y, this trace, if you want, dy, so now I am in even dimension, so it's n, but n is equal to 2m, okay, and this is equal to gamma. Okay, so this is the equation. I'm sorry, there is a square root of kappa here. Okay, okay, but this is nothing. This is like a factor of I when kappa is equal to minus 1. So okay, so this is the equation. There is a 1 over n factorial if you want to normalize things, but okay, I don't care for that. Yeah, gamma is a gamma 5 matrix. Okay, this is the Z2 grading. Okay, so this is Z2 grading. Okay, so we look at this equation. And what did we find? We computed. I think Ali will be giving you, you know, the formula in coordinates and so on. But I want to give you some mathematical formula, okay? And the mathematical formula that you get, which is a general formula, doesn't use this equation. In general, you get the following. You see, because y squared is 1, okay, because y squared is 1, y, in fact, the coordinates, you find out that the coordinates of y commute with each other, okay? And because gamma star is minus gamma and so on, you find that the coordinates are self-adjoint. So you find that in all cases, YA star is equal to YA. And the YAs commute with each other. So YA, YB is equal to YB, YA. This is quite easy. This comes from the fact that the terms in the square of Y have to eliminate each other. Okay? So they commute, they are self-adjoint. And moreover, the sum of their square is equal to 1. So the sum of the YA square is equal to 1. Okay? So they in fact, Y is a map from the manifold, if you start with the manifold, to the sphere Sn. Okay? And what do you find after doing a little computation? You find the following equation, which doesn't depend on anything else. what you find is that gamma times the expectation value of y dy to this power n, okay? If you multiply this by square root of g times dnx, okay? So this is the volume of the Riemannian manifold, of the metric of the Riemannian manifold. Yeah, but there are n plus 1 gammas. This is a very important point. Okay? There are n plus 1 gammas. That's an extremely important point. Okay? So the number of gammas is not n. Okay? It's n plus 1. This is fundamental. Okay? This is fundamental. So what you find out is that if you multiply by the volume of the Riemannian manifold, the volume, it's not a form, but when you multiply this by gamma, it becomes a differential form because it depends on the orientation. Okay? You find that this is exactly equal to the pullback by the map Y of the volume form of the oriented sphere. Okay? So this is the volume form of the oriented unit sphere. By unit sphere, I don't mean the sphere of unit volume. I mean the sphere of unit radius, okay, which doesn't have volume 1. Okay, so that's the equation that you find. And you can see that if I change orientation, this behaves like a form, okay, and this behaves like a polynomial in Y, which is the correct thing here. Okay, so immediately when we studied this equation, we said, damned thing cannot be quantum gravity, because imagine we have solution of this equation. Okay, imagine you have solution of this equation. If I have solution of this, might be there is a square root of kappa, let me ignore it. Okay, if I have a solution to this equation, what does it mean? Yes, there is a square root of kappa. Okay, what does it mean? It means, after all, that I can replace this y dy by this thing, okay? Okay, and then I don't know. I mean, it's something easy to find. Okay, so what would happen then is the following. What would happen is that if I replace now y dy by this value, which is square root of kappa perhaps times gamma, but let me ignore this term. Gamma square is 1. Okay, and what I find that the volume form. Okay, the volume has to be equal to this, and this implies that if I take the pullback of the volume form of the oriented sphere, it is a differential form that doesn't vanish anywhere. Okay, so it means that the Jacobian of the map Y cannot vanish anywhere. This means that the map Y is a covering of the sphere, but the sphere is simply connected, I mean, in dimension bigger than 1. So from that you deduce that the manifold has to be a covering of the sphere. And the covering of the sphere, of course, it needs to be totally disconnected in pieces, each piece being a sphere. So then, at that point of our collaboration, we had a kind of a bubble interlude. And when we would meet, okay, I mean, I would draw this little picture here. And the size of these little bubbles had to be Planckian size, because Planck size is the only size which you have when you try to do, you know, gravity and all that. So this would have meant that whatever manifold we are talking about, this manifold would decompose into small bubbles, each having a unit Planckian volume, but arbitrary shape otherwise. Arbitrary shape, okay? And, okay, I mean, so so we called them quanta of geometry. That was fine. But I mean, it wasn't clear at all several things. I mean, it was clear why we had been working with spheres, okay, because this was the only possibility. Okay, but there was some feeling of unsatisfaction. And this feeling of unsatisfaction was totally relieved when we realized that, you know, when you actually play with little bubbles, if you are smart enough, these little bubbles will coalesce together, and they will form something which is of much bigger size. Okay, so that's what I'm going to explain now, and this is what happens. And so we realized that, you know, there was no, but of course for that we need to put two kinds of bubbles, and we need to put them together. And when we are doing that, we realized that we had been ignoring an absolutely fundamental piece of structure which is present in non-commutative geometry, and which is already present in the cohomology cycles. And that's the following. You see, so this is in particular the work of Sullivan in the 70s and such people, because what they had found is something which is quite meaningful and which people don't know in general, which is that, you ask the following question: when is the space a manifold? So you are given the space up to homotopy. The first thing that you find is that if the space is manifold, say a smooth compact manifold, up to homotopy, then it has to satisfy Poincaré duality in ordinary homology. But the converse is not true. You can assume simple connectedness and all that, but the converse is not true. And then when you try to find the converse, you find out that you need a more precise Poincaré duality, and it's Poincaré duality, okay, in a theory which is more precise than ordinary homology, and which is more precise than K-homology, it's K-O-homology. And what is the nuance between K-homology, like here, and K-O-homology? Well, it's an operator which is called J. It's an operator which, in the physics language, is also well known. It's not the chirality operator, it's the charge conjugation operator. Okay, and what you get after doing that, you find out that there are 8 theories. It's like, you know, in the case of ordinary cohomology, there are 2 theories, even and odd, but now there are 8 theories according to commutation relations, which are fulfilled by J and everything else. And so at some point, we realized that we had been ignoring this J, and that if we reinsert the operator J, then we can write a more fancy form of the equation that combines the case kappa is 1 and the case kappa is equal to minus 1. And so what is this equation? Remember that, I mean, of course, y satisfies y squared is equal to 1. So y is the same, I mean, it's the same data, okay, as a projection. And what is the projection? The projection is E, E is equal to 1 plus Y over 2. Okay, and of course you recover. You have Y is equal to 2E minus 1. Okay. Now, the beauty of the J operator is that not only it's fundamental for cohomology and so on, but it's also related to the Tomita operator of Tomita's theory. And it has the big property that it sends the algebra to its commutant. So if you want, this is a general fact, which we call the order zero condition, but that if you take A, A will commute with G B star J inverse for any A and B in the algebra. So for any A and B, we shall have these commutation relations. And then what does it mean? It means that together with the Y, there will be J Y, J inverse. And so together with E, there will be another thing, which we call E prime, which is G E, G inverse. Okay. And then, I mean, it's a very simple fact, of course, that if you take two projections which commute, here they commute, their product is still a projection. So what we defined, we took this operator Z, which is the Y corresponding to the product of E and E prime. So Z is equal to 2 E E prime minus 1. Then we wrote the same equation. So then we wrote our fundamental equation. So this is the fundamental equation. So this is the main equation. And it reestablishes the symmetry between the left and the right, if you want, between the plus 1 and the minus 1. So the main equation is that this z times dz, let me now go move to dimension 4 because is equal to gamma. Okay, up to normalization. Okay, so this is the main equation, where z is given by this. Okay. Okay, and then what happened is that after so two things happened. So two things, two absolutely crucial things happened. So the first thing which happened, okay, so the one and two, if you want. Okay, the first thing which happened was the following, was that, you know, when you combine, when you look at the y, okay, you have, of course, to combine it with the gamma mu's. I mean, the y is a combination of gamma mu's. And as I was writing, you know, you have y is equal to ya, sorry, ya gamma a, okay? So what you would do, of course, I mean, you know, you have to generate an algebra from the components ya and the gamma a's. I mean, this is the natural algebra. So this natural algebra, it will be an algebra of functions with values in the algebra, real algebra, because the y's are self-adjoint, generated by the gamma a's. Okay? So the first thing that we did was to compute the algebra generated by the gamma a's. So we compute the algebra generated by the gamma a's in the two cases. So there was the case, if you want, kappa is equal to 1, and the case kappa is equal to minus 1. Okay? And in the case kappa is equal to 1, so we are in four dimensions. When we computed the algebra generated by the gamma a's for kappa is equal to 1, we found 2 by 2 matrices of quaternions. So it's the Clifford algebra. It's the Clifford algebra on 5 pluses. Plus, okay? When you compute this Clifford algebra, you find that it is the direct sum of 2 copies of M2 of H. But we are in an irreducible representation, so we have only 1 copy of M2 of H. So we found M2 of H, okay? And then we computed the Clifford algebra where we take now 5 minuses, so Clifford minus, okay? And what did we find? You look at the table. You find it's M4 of C. Okay. Now, you might wonder, how can it be that here I have something which has dimension 32 over the reals, here I have something which has dimension 16 over the reals. And the reason is the following. The reason is that when you look at M4 of C, it does indeed have 2 different irreducible representations according to the action is C linear or C anti-linear. But in both of these irreducible representations, the algebra it generates is the M4 of C. Okay, now, this was a great moment. Why? Because with Ali, we had written a paper some time ago, and with Walter, you know, and in that paper, that joint paper, I mean, at first, with Ali, we had found this algebra M2 of H with M4C, but then with Walter, we wrote a paper in which, you know, we analyzed completely the model that you get from that. What is it? This algebra of functions, real value with values in these 2 Clifford algebra, are exactly the algebras which you have to input in order to get the standard model coupled to a manifold, okay? So it was very strange that it would be algebras with real values, okay? Here they appear naturally. And it was very strange also, and this we couldn't explain at all, that it was an algebra where on one side we would have a 16-dimensional, on the other side we would have a 32-dimensional stuff, okay? Now, in our paper with Walter, the 3 of us, what we have done, we have found that it generates at first the Patti-Salam model. And this Patti-Salam model is actually known to be the minimal asymptotically free extension of the standard model. So it's really an ideal thing in the sense that no physicist would believe that, you know, the ultimate theory would not be asymptotically free because this is a criterion for well-definedness in mathematics. And so this is what we found. So this was the first miracle. First miracle was that we found, without looking for it, we were not trying to get the standard. No, We are not looking for it. We are trying to find, you know, solutions of these equations that would allow to write functions in a simpler manner on a manifold. Okay, and so we found this first thing. Okay, second thing. Then we were very. There was a big problem because now you have these two things, and of course, I mean, it would have been a disaster if it had been a sum of little quantas like that. Now, what do we gain by the fact that we have these two things? Well, what do we gain? We gain that instead of having just y or e, if you want, we have two. We have y and y prime. So now when you write this equation, which holds in general, so this equation here holds in general, but now it turns out that when you compute, so when you compute, what you find out is you find out that it's not a trivial computation at all, but what you find out is that when you compute this z, dz, so on, you know, the one which I wrote in this equation, the z, dz to the 4, okay? So when you compute this z, dz, this z, dz to the power 4, okay? Then what you get, it turns out that you get y, dy to the power 4, plus y prime, dy prime, sorry, dy prime to the power 4. I mean, you have to use a lot of stuff in order to prove that. It's not a trivial fact at all, okay? And, okay, so now, sorry? No, because, yeah, but you have e and e prime. So, yeah, but you have, z is a function of e and e prime. E prime is, of course, different. It is, but you see, remember that the J, you are like in a sum of two Hilbert spaces, okay? And the J is put back here, and so it acts on the right, so it acts independently of the other one, okay? Yes, okay? So, I mean, it acts on the other side, the E prime, okay? It's like the bimodule structure, okay? So, if you want, it's like the Y is like, there is a Y plus here, or Y minus here, and the J puts it back here, so it's acting on two sides. So the E prime is not at all the same as E, okay? You have two independent things. So what you have is you have two maps to the sphere, Y and Y prime, okay? Yes, of course. We use the order one. We use everything which is available, okay? I mean, in fact, we have written the list of things we use, but I mean, they are, of course, preponderant, okay? So now you rewrite this equation. That equation which I had written here is true for all y's, okay? So now I can compute, I can multiply everything by gamma and by square root of g dnx, and what do I get? I get that gamma times z dz to the 4, okay, times square root of g d4x, okay? What do I get? I get that now it's equal to the sum of the two, okay? So I get that this is equal to y star of V plus Y prime star of V, okay? And now you see that you begin to have some hope that by allowing two Y's, you would be able to do the stuff, okay? So, when you see that, okay, you try, of course, to, so what do you find out from this? Okay. Yeah, I know, but I mean, I am just at the beginning, okay? But no, so now let me tell you something very, very important. So now, okay, it was a mathematical problem, and what was the mathematical problem? The mathematical problem was to find for which manifold you can...
I will give you my spot.
After the coffee? Yeah. I will accept only if you promise to rescue me if I did. No, but I will pass it on to you. I mean, I just need perhaps 15 minutes, you know. So. No, but you have to be prepared because then I will switch to you, okay? For the physics. Okay. Okay. No, but this is the most important point. You see, so what happens now is the following. What happens is that you conclude from this thing that the following theorem okay, the following theorem, which is a preparation. So the theorem which is a preparation is the following, is that let M be a four manifold, be an oriented four manifold. Okay, then what you find out is then a solution of the two-sided equation exists. Is equivalent to the fact that there are two maps, so there exist maps y, y prime from M to the fourth sphere, okay, such that. Okay, now I am going to be very precise. So what I am going to say is that such that the pullback y star of V plus y prime star of V, that's a differential form on the manifold M, does not vanish anywhere on M. Okay, and so this is the first condition. And the second condition is that the volume of M belongs to is equal to the degree of y plus the degree of y prime, okay, times, of course, the volume of the unit sphere, volume of S4. Okay? And, okay. So, yeah. So, from that, what do you see? You see two things which are absolutely incredible. The first thing is that, as Ali was saying, the volume is quantized. Okay, and saying that the volume is quantized is something which is the quantum gravity, is extremely important. Why? Because when you look at the spectral action, remember that the spectral action begins by lambda to the 4 times the volume, okay, the integral of square root of g d4x on M. And then you have a term lambda square where you have Einstein and so on. Okay. And this term was always bothering us for obvious reasons, because it dominates the spectral action. Okay. But now if the volume is quantized, the fact that the volume is quantized tells you that when you will vary this action in the nearby, in the neighborhood, and so on, the volume cannot move in an infinitesimal manner. So it will not contribute to the field equations. Okay. And so the field equations will deliver exactly the right thing, namely the Einstein equations coupled to matter. No, it's only 4. And I will explain why, okay? So it's only valid for 4. Okay, so now let me tell you the most important thing, except perhaps, yes. Okay, yeah. After? No. Yeah, let me tell you the most important thing. Okay. Okay, so let me tell you the most important thing. Most important thing now is the following. Yes? Let's wait a bit. Yes? It's this equation with a Z. It is this equation with a Z. It's the equation Z, sorry, no, I didn't, I did, yes, the two-sided equation is the equation Z dz to the fourth average value is equal to gamma. Okay, so, there is no kappa anymore. No, it's equal to gamma, okay? So that's the two-sided equation. So now the theorem is that for a solution to the two-sided equation to exist, it's necessary and sufficient that there are two maps to the fourth sphere, okay, such that when you pull back the volume form of the sphere, you get a differential form that doesn't vanish anywhere, and moreover, that the volume of M is quantized. Okay? So how do you prove this? Well, it follows from a result of Jürgen Moser, that if you take, so it's a little paper by Jürgen Moser who proved that if you take differential forms which do not vanish anywhere and which have the same volume, they are diffeomorphic. Okay? That's the theorem of Jürgen Moser. So Now imagine that you can find two maps to y and y prime to the sphere, okay? Now the pullback of the volume form of the sphere will not be the volume form of the Riemannian manifold. It will not be equal. But if you have this equality that the volume of M is equal to this, they will have the same total volume, these two differential forms. And because they have the same total volume, they are diffeomorphic. And because they are diffeomorphic, you can correct the y and the y prime so that actually the two volumes are the two volume forms are equal. Okay, by precomposing y and y prime with this diffeomorphism. Okay, so this follows from this theorem of Jürgen Moser. Okay? No, for any manifold. For any manifold. Jürgen Moser proved that for any manifold, if you want, it's like in gravity, you don't have any problem with the volume. Because all volumes are diffeomorphic. So you can reduce the gauge to a fixed volume. This is what people did with unimodular gravity. Okay? So, but I mean, it's very important here that this comes into play. So you have this fact, okay? Now, of course, you have a big mathematical problem. And the mathematical problem is the following. The mathematical problem is to find out for which manifolds M is it possible, each for which four manifold M, is it possible to find two maps to the four sphere so that when you pull back the volume form of the four sphere, it doesn't vanish anywhere. I think it's a good time for a break and coffee. <Yes. laughs> And then we switch. Eh? I mean, at some point, you have to get up and talk, okay? Okay. He's a tricky guy. Yeah, well, questions can be postponed to the next talk. Are you happy?
All right, so in case you missed the first talk, you have a second charge.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so let me go at the place where I stopped in the first talk. Okay, which is this result. Okay. And then you see when you have this result. Then, I mean, there is a corresponding mathematical problem. So there is a corresponding mathematical problem, which is to find out for which manifolds, so for which four manifolds, you have such maps y and y prime. And okay, there is a well-known principle in mathematics, you know, which is that if you have a problem, for instance, if I ask you. If I take a chocolate table, you know, of 4 times 8, how many snaps you have to do so that you transform it into a single squares? Oh my God, you know, I don't know how to do that. So what do? You replace it by 2 by 1, you know. Okay, there you can do it. Okay, and then, you know, you gradually get to the point. So here it's the same, we shall do the same. So in other words, what we shall do, we shall start with 2 dimensions, and then we shall go up to 3 dimensions, and then eventually we go up to 4 dimensions. Okay, and if we go to 2 dimensions, oops, to 2 dimensions, yeah, it's a pity to do that, so let me use this. So if we go to 2 dimensions, it's not too difficult to do the job. Okay, so what we have, we have a 2-manifold. Yeah, okay, sure. So we have a 2-manifold, we have a surface, okay? And what we are trying to do, so we take a surface, okay? And what we are trying to do, we are trying to find 2 mappings from this surface, y and y prime, to the 2-sphere, S2, in such a way that when we pull back the volume form, it doesn't vanish anywhere. Okay, and what we would like, of course, is that you know, this sum of 2 degrees gets quite high because we would like, if you want, that the volume of the manifold can be quite big in Planck units. After all, you know, the sphere will have like unit volume. So we want something which is macroscopic. Okay. So this is what we try to do. And how, what is the idea? The idea goes back to Alexander in 1920. It's a beautiful idea. So the idea is the following. The idea of Alexander is the following, is that you triangulate this thing. Okay, so you triangulate. So you know what is triangulation. Okay, there are plenty of little triangles. And then what you want to do, you want to organize these triangles in a chessboard so that alternatively they are white and black. And there is a nice way to do this, which is to take what is called the barycentric subdivision of the triangles. And when you take the barycentric subdivision, you have you can not only color the triangles which are inside into black and white, but you can even do better because you can actually label their vertices by 0, 1, 2, okay, according to the dimension of the simplex to which they belong. So for instance, all the points which are here will be labeled 0, all the points which are here will be labeled 1 because the dimension of the simplex is 1, and the point which is here will be labeled 2. And then what you do, you color them in black or white according to the orientation agreement between the orientation defined by 0, 1, 2 and the ambient orientation. So for instance, this one would be black. This one would be white. This one would be black. And this one would be black. So by doing that, going to the next triangle, you find out easily that the orientations match actually. They alternate. You get a chessboard. You get a beautiful chessboard. And once you have this chessboard, which is done of black and white triangles, what you do is you think of your S2 as colored into two colors. So there is, this is a black part, and this is a white part. Okay, and you think of it not as a sphere, but you think of it as two simplices which are glued together. So they are glued together according to their boundary. And so they are like two triangles, if you want, which are glued together according to their boundary. And they are labeled again 0, 1, 2. And they are glued according to the right thing. So what you do now is that you map by a canonical map the black triangles to the black part of the sphere. And you map the white triangles to the white part of the sphere. Okay? And you can make a little computer program, which I did because I like to play with the computer, where when you move the point on the surface, you see how it moves on the sphere. And when you do that, you can easily imagine what happens. What happens is that when you move along in this manifold, you see that it wraps around the sphere many, many times. Okay? It wraps in the sphere many, many times. And what you can see also is the following, that this map is, you can make it smooth. This doesn't take much brain. Okay? And moreover, you can even make it smooth through the edges of the triangles. So when you cross the edge of a triangle, you cross the edge which is here smoothly. The only place where it's a little bit tricky are the vertices. Okay, so what will happen at the vertices will be tricky. There is what is called ramification. You can make it smooth still. You can make it smooth, but you cannot make the Jacobian not vanish. And of course, this you know because I mean you couldn't have a covering of the sphere by a surface like this. So there are ramifications, and so this means that in fact, you know, the three vertices of the triangle, the two triangles that you are gluing together, there will be ramification. So there will be three points where it ramifies. And here, all the vertices, there will be ramification. So there are plenty of points on the sphere where this map, which I call Y, will actually have a Jacobian which vanishes. Okay? So it's not yet a solution. It's not a solution of the one-sided equation because it has Jacobian which vanishes. Okay? On the other hand, what you can see is that the place where it vanishes has codimension 2. So the singular set, if you want, the singular set, which is where the y star of v of x equals 0, okay, is of codimension 2. is of codimension 2. Now I want to stop a little bit on that because it's something which is hiding something very important. You see, normally if I write a map to the sphere in coordinates, and if I write where the Jacobian vanishes for this map, I get one equation. One equation normally defines an hypersurface. So normally I should get a dimension one subspace, okay, of this. I don't. Why don't I get, what is the origin of the fact that I don't get codimension one? It's complex analysis. Because think of the map, the simplest ramifying map is a map, for instance, z goes to z to the power n. Okay? Look at this map. Okay? Now look at this map as a map from c to c. Okay? But look at it as a real map. Okay? As a map from a real two-dimensional manifold to a real two-dimensional manifold. Look at the place where its Jacobian vanishes. The Jacobian is given by the n z to the n minus 1. Okay? So you are looking for where this vanishes. But where z vanishes is z equals 0. It's codimension 2. Okay? Now you could ask me, is it possible to find something of codimension 3? And the answer is no. Why is it not possible? It's not possible. For instance, you could try with quaternions. Okay? I could try to take the map, quaternion q goes to quaternion q to the n. But when you will compute the derivative of quaternion q to the n, you will get several quaternions in several places. It will not be just the simple derivative like this. And it cannot be. Why it cannot be? It cannot be because once you have a ramified cover like this, the ramified cover is entirely determined by the monodromy. And the monodromy, for the monodromy to exist, it has to be such that the complement of a point in a space, which is the codimension that you are looking at, is not simply connected. And this only happens when the space is dimension 2. In dimension 3, it would never happen. Okay? So you are stuck. Okay? So you are stuck. You know that you can lower the dimension of the singular set, okay, to codimension 2, but not further. Okay? So the codimension is 2, I mean, maximally speaking, but not further. Okay? So now how do you get the two maps in dimension 2? Well, it's very, very simple. Move y by a diffeomorphism of this a little bit. Then you will get another map y where the singular set now, which I write with a little round like this, will be disjoint from the previous one. Okay? Now, both maps actually, except where they are singular, they preserve the orientation. They have a positive Jacobian. Why? Because the orientation has to be constant on the complement of the singular set. So, you know, it has to be preserved. Okay? So, what happens if I take the y prime now? What happens if I take the y prime is that when I look at the pullback of the volume form by y, okay, y star v, and I add y prime star v, if I take any point x, well, you know, the bad points will be either ramification points for the first one or ramification points for the other, but they are disjoint. So I'm done, okay? I have the two maps. And what is the degree? What is the total degree? It is the sum of the degree of y and the degree of y prime. So, okay, I mean, here I have taken them so that they have the same degree, so it's an even number, but I mean, you could easily remove. And you could actually take two different triangulations. And by taking many, 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 many triangles in the triangulation, I can make it as big as I want. Okay? So that certainly works. That certainly works. But it tells us something. It tells us that the singular set has codimension 2. Okay? So this is what we learn. We learn that the singular set, so in dimension n now, in dimension n, okay, the singular set, I will call it sigma, the sigma of y, singular set, sigma of y, okay, as codimension 2, as the best, I mean, as codimension 2. It cannot have lower codimension. As codimension 2, okay? In other words, it has dimension n minus 2, right? Dimension equals n minus 2. So let us try n equals 3, okay? Let us try n equals 3. Okay, so if we take n equals 3 and we apply this technique of Alexander, what do we find? We find that the place where it ramifies now is no longer formed of points, but it's formed of one-dimensional pieces, okay? And in fact, by more work, you can make them to be nodes, okay? So you find one-dimensional, so the sigma of y is of dimension one. Okay, so that's what you find. Okay, but then you can do the same trick, because what is true is that if you have a subset of dimension one and if you move it by a diffeomorphism, okay, if you take, so I take a small piece of dimension one, okay, and I move it, I take another piece of dimension one, okay, so this is, let me call it sigma one and call this sigma two. So I take two little pieces of dimension one, okay, then what I claim, now of course they might intersect, okay, they might intersect. But I am in dimension three. So what I claim is that there exists a diffeomorphism psi, so that psi of sigma one is disjoint from sigma two. Okay? Not only there exists a psi, which is pretty obvious, but the set of psi which fulfills this property is an open dense set in diffeomorphisms. Okay? So now if I have a union of such things, I know that an intersection of countably many dense open sets is non-empty. This is a bare property. Okay, so from that, you know that generically, in fact, if you take a diffeomorphism, it will make it disjoint from itself. Okay, so what you do, you take your y, and you define your y prime to be y composed with this diffeomorphism psi. Okay, and you are done. I mean, now they have disjoint singular set. Okay, so you can go. Okay, so in dimension three, everything is fine. What about dimension four? Dimension four, you meet a wall, okay? And why do you meet a wall in dimension four? Okay, so why do you meet a wall in dimension four? Because in dimension four, the codimension two, what does it mean? It means that now the singular set sigma of y, the dimension of sigma of y, is equal to two. Okay, but two subsets of dimension two, they intersect. No way. I mean, you can try to make two subsets of dimension two not intersect. There is no way. Okay, they have a non-trivial, in fact, cohomological intersection number. So, I mean, you cannot get away. Okay, cannot get away. So when we saw that with Ali, we were, and with Slava, you know, we were a little bit worried. So we looked at examples. We were able to show that if we take S4, it works, of course. If we take S3 cross S1, it works also by the same trick as before, and so on, by sort of reduction to dimension three and so on. But then, you know. And then I decided to do something which I never did before, which is to write to my friends, geometers. You know. Okay, so I first wrote to Donaldson, and then I wrote to Dennis Sullivan, and then I wrote to Etienne Gis. Dennis didn't answer. I mean, so I don't know. But Donaldson answered after 1 week, and he gave very important information, but though completely cryptic. But that information was extremely important. And also, I had written to Etienne Gis, because in the meantime, I mean, Donaldson had not answered and so on. And for Etienne wrote to me first an email. He said, okay, I gave your problem to top geometers where he is and so on, and they cannot do anything. Okay. But after a while, I will tell you how it happened. And they all contributed. They all contributed. So there are two geometers in Lyon, I mean, which are explained in the paper and gave a key contribution. But I will come back to that. Okay, and the idea of Donaldson, which then, okay, I transformed into a lemma, but he didn't give any indication. He just gave some, okay? So, but he gave something which gave a new idea. And the new idea is the following, is that why one should try to take y prime of the same form as y. One can try to take y prime in a different form as y. I mean, there is no reason that y and y prime should play a symmetrical role. Okay, so I am going to explain how this idea eventually comes to the what you want to do. Okay, and in the meantime, I mean, in the meantime, these two guys in Lyon, I mean, they had found that there is counterexample with P2 of C. So if you take projective space of dimension 2, P2 of C, you cannot find, I will explain why, you cannot find two maps to the fourth sphere network, okay? Okay, but I will explain why there is a miracle and why it works for what we want to do. Okay. Okay, so this is the situation. No, wait, I don't tell you. Okay. Okay, so now let me explain. Let me explain the idea that, okay, was sort of resulted from the correspondence with Donaldson, okay, and which is absolutely key in this business. So the idea is that we don't want to use the same, we don't want to use the same technique. So we want to use a different technique for the other map. Okay. We of course we use the idea of Alexander, but we want to use another. Sorry.
You say that the y prime should derive from y by cross conjugation?
No, not at all. No, no. No, there is no relation, there is no a priori relation between y and y prime. I will come back to that later. Okay, so there is no relation, and we have the freedom to choose y prime, okay? Okay, so now what is the idea? What is the idea? The idea is the following. The idea is that, let's assume that we have constructed our map y, okay? The place where y is bothering is the sigma of y. So now sigma of y, okay, let us say that it's a union of surfaces, the union of two-dimensional surfaces. Well, I don't know that they are smooth, but two-dimensional surfaces, you know, which are, let me call them sigma alpha, if you want, sigma I, which are contained in M. Okay, but they are two-dimensional surfaces. They are two-dimensional surfaces. Now, the idea of Donaldson, I think what he did is to consider a simpler problem. Okay, he considered a simpler problem, which is not the problem of actually finding that the sum of the two pullbacks is non-zero, but he considers the problem that either one or the other would not vanish. Okay? Okay? And then he gave the idea for that, which is a simpler thing. So what you want to do, you want to find two maps, y and y prime, okay, such that if in the place where y is singular, so sigma of y on sigma of y, then it's y prime which will be okay. Okay. So how do you do that? How do you do that? Well, you see, it's a union of surfaces. So you have these surfaces which are inside. They might be a little bit singular, but and they are inside the big manifold. So this is M4, okay? And you have these surfaces inside. Now, the idea is the following. The idea is that you are going now to take a neighborhood, like a tubular neighborhood, of this little surface. So this will be like sigma 1. Okay? And you take a tubular neighborhood V1, which contains sigma 1. Okay? And now you try to find a map from V1 to the sphere, but which is such that on V1 is good. Okay? Okay? So this is a new idea. So you only look in the neighborhood of where the other one is bad, okay? Okay. Okay. But then after that, okay. So how do you do that? In order to do that, the only thing that you need, so you look for an immersion. You look for an immersion. Because if the map is not singular, it means it's an immersion, okay? Of each sigma j, but rather, I mean, of a neighborhood of each sigma j. So it's a neighborhood, I will call it vj, of each sigma j in R4. In R4. Okay? So you look for such an immersion of a neighborhood of each sigma j in R4. And so I don't tell you then, I don't yet tell you how we are going to combine these things together. But at least now we have a kind of local problem. Okay, we look at each sigma j and we look whether there is an immersion of a neighborhood of each sigma j in R4. Now, sigma j has dimension 4. Okay, sigma j has dimension 4. Oh, sorry, vj has dimension 4. So Vj has dimension 4. Now, it turns out that, so there was, so at first I began to look at these things, and I could do it in the case when the manifold sigma 1, sigma j was orientable. Because when the manifold is orientable, then you find out that because the manifold M4 is orientable, you can actually do it, okay? But then, okay, I was stuck, and gradually, I mean, I was talking with Blaine Lawson also, and gradually I realized that there was a theory which was extremely powerful, and this is the Smale theory, okay, which is exactly which is the Smale theory of immersion. So it's Smale Hirsch, okay, and the theory of immersions. And you know, this is the theory in which they show that you can return the two sphere inside out by through immersions. Okay, so it's a highly non-trivial theory. Okay, moreover, I found in the literature I found the adaptation to that of that theory to equal dimension. So in other words, you ask, when is it possible that a manifold of dimension n can be immersed in Rn with the same n? You know, of course. And it turns out that there is a theorem which is deduced from the Smale-Hirsch theory of immersion, which is a theorem which is due to Poincaré. And his theorem is the following. So the theorem of Poincaré is that let W be an open, it's absolutely crucial that it's open, be an open manifold. Okay, by open manifold, I mean you don't have a fundamental cycle, okay? Be an open manifold connected of dimension n, okay? Then W can be immersed, immersed in Rn. This is equivalent to saying that W is parallelizable. I mean, it's obvious that there is implication here. It's obvious that if it can be immersed in Rn, the tangent bundle is the pullback of the trivial bundle, so it's parallelizable, okay? What is extremely non-trivial is the converse, okay? Is that if you take a manifold which is parallelizable, then it can be immersed if it's open. Of course, it's wrong for the circle. The circle cannot be immersed in it, okay? So, but I mean, if it's open, it's okay. So amazing result, okay? Amazingly powerful result. So now we know what we are doing, we have to prove. What we have to know is that this neighborhood is parallelizable. Because if it is parallelizable, then you can find an immersion from this neighborhood into R4, okay? Okay, so let me first tell you, before I enter into why or not it's parallelizable, let me first tell you how we assemble these immersions now. So now what we have these little surfaces inside, okay, and for each of these neighborhood of these little surfaces, we have an immersion into R4, okay? Okay, so now the new idea was the following. The new idea was that now we want to combine these things. How do we combine these things? How do we combine these things together? Well, we can. They are disjoint, yes. They are disjoint, so you can assume that the neighborhoods also are disjoint. Moreover, you can assume also that the immersions, so there will be an immersion, let me call it theta j, okay, from sigma j. You can assume that the immersions preserve the orientation. Okay, because you could change the orientation in the target. I mean, you could change the coordinates in the target. So you have orientation preserving immersions on each of these things. Okay? Okay. So now what do we do? Next step, let's assume that we have these immersions, theta j, from these neighborhoods and so on. Okay? Then I claim that we can extend, okay, the theta j's to a single map, single smooth map, theta, from manifold M to R4. Okay, how do you do that? You do that because you extend the coordinates. You see? It's a map to R4. So what do we have? We have smooth maps from these things to R, each coordinate. We extend each coordinate, and we get a map to R4. Okay? But we are not done. We are not done yet. So what do we know now? Now we know that we have a map from the manifold to R4, which in the bad set coincides with this theta j. So it's an immersion in the bad set. Okay? But we don't know what it does elsewhere. Okay? We don't know what it does elsewhere. Okay? So what do we do now? Now we view R4 inside S4. Okay? As a unit ball, say. So R is, theta goes to R4, but of course M is compact, so it goes in. So theta goes to B4, let's say, which is inside S4. Okay, it goes to unit ball B4, which is inside S4. Okay, now comes the trick. Okay, now comes the trick. So what is the trick? It took me really some time to find this trick. So the trick now is the following. The trick is that, so now we have a solution to the weaker problem of finding either one map or the other as a Jacobian which doesn't vanish. But we don't know about the sum of the two. And it could be that the theta is absolutely spoiling the map, the sum of the two. We don't know that. Okay. So how are we going to handle that? Well, we are going to handle that by rescaling. So what is the idea? The idea, yes. So what is the idea? The idea is to set y prime is equal to lambda theta. I rescale theta. I rescale. Okay. So theta was landing in the unit ball. Okay. Theta was landing in the unit ball, and it was giving me something, which was the image theta of m. Okay. And now I rescale everything, so I make it much smaller. Okay, I rescale it. And when I rescale it, what happens to the Jacobian? Okay, because after all, the volume form of the sphere, when I restrict to the B, is almost the standard volume form on R4. I mean, you know, it's like dx1, wedge dx2, wedge dx3, sorry, wedge dx4. Now you can argue that there is a function here, but okay, that function is smooth, so it will take a constant value when I rescale. Okay, so now when I take the pullback form here, what do I get? I get d of theta 1, wedge d of theta 2. Okay, where these are the components of theta, wedge d of theta 4. Okay, but if I rescale theta, I get a lambda to the 4 in front. Okay, now, because I get a lambda to the 4 in front, I can make my lambda so small that outside the bad place, outside these neighborhoods, okay, the Jacobian of the map y prime, okay, so the pullback, if you want, y prime of the volume form V of the sphere, y prime star, will be very, very small compared to the given volume form on the manifold M, as small as I want. And so it will not spoil the fact that y star of V was positive. Because when I add it, I add epsilon. And this epsilon, because the pullback of the first one, y star of V outside these neighborhoods has some minimum. You know, it's positive compared to a volume form. So it doesn't vanish. So it has a minimum size. If I rescale by a size which is smaller, I don't touch it. Okay. Moreover, both are positive or zero, so when I add them, I get something which doesn't vanish, because even though the other one is very, very tiny, so this is the idea of gluing the bubbles. Now you glue the spherical bubbles. You glue them on these things. Okay, but now you come to the problem, and the problem is the following. Okay, fine. So you know now that if you can do things locally like this, you are done. But you still have to prove that on these neighborhoods, the manifold W is parallelizable. Okay, on these neighborhoods. Okay, and now you begin to think, and this thought I had before, knowing about the space theory actually. Okay, so you begin to think, how can this be? And you find out that there is the witness theory of real vector bundles, and there are witness classes, which are the obstruction for a bundle to be non-trivial. And so you have to look at the witness classes. Okay, and so in fact, what you have to do is you have to look. But you are. You see, these neighborhoods have a homotopical dimension too, because they retract on these surfaces. So we look at the obstruction on the tangent bundle to be trivial on Tm, the tangent bundle of M, restricted to these surfaces, okay, sigma j, to be trivial. Okay, now the non-obstruction in dimension 2 is the second Stifel-Whitney class, because Tm, of course, is orientable, so it has vanishing first Stifel-Whitney class. So we have to look at W2 of Tm restricted to sigma j. Okay, I mean, this is the a priori obstruction. This is a Stifel-Whitney class, okay, W2. Okay, so this is Stifel-Whitney class, and it's W2, not W4, because you restrict to a two-dimensional piece, okay? And so what you find out is that, okay, I mean, this would be an obstruction. When you look at the counterexample of these great geometers from Lyon, P2 of C, you find that for P2 of C, it's well known that if you take P2 of C, it is a double ramified cover of the sphere S4, and it ramifies on P2 of R. Okay. And if you look at the restriction of the Stifel-Whitney class of the tangent bundle of P2 of C to P2 of R, you find exactly a non-trivial class. In fact, since I knew that for orientable surfaces it worked, I'd look at this example. And I had guessed it was a counterexample. They proved it, and I will tell you why it's a counterexample. Okay. But now, look. W2 of Tm restricted to sigma j, because it's a characteristic class, is the same thing. It's equal to W2 of Tm, okay, restricted to sigma j. In other words, it's a characteristic class, so you don't have to look, you know, at the restriction of the tangent bundle. You can take the second Stifel-Whitney class and restrict to sigma j. But now, well, we know that in physics we work with spin manifolds. And the Dirac operator requires a spin structure. For a manifold to be spin, the necessary insufficient condition is that W2 of the manifold is zero. Okay? So what we know is that this obstruction, this obvious obstruction, does vanish in our case. We are not done, but we know it vanishes. Okay? So we know that in our case, this is zero. So we are not quite done. Okay, but so let me tell you how you finish. You finish in the following way. You have to be a little, because W2, it's a stable class, if you want. It doesn't tell you that the bundle is trivial. It tells you that, you know, there is an obstruction for the bundle to be trivial, which is vanishing, okay? So how do you finish here? You finish it like this. You say, after all, you know, the manifold is spin. To say that the manifold is spin, it tells you that the tangent bundle is classified by a map not to be SO4, which would be the standard thing for a manifold of dimension 4, but in fact it's classified by this map leaves to be spin 4. Okay? The classifying space of spin 4. Now, spin 4 has a topology which is S3 cos S3. When you take B spin 4, it has a change in homotopy groups by 1. So it's a space which is three-connected. And for a space which is three-connected, when you look at homotopy classes of maps from a two-manifold, from a two-space, the space which is three-connected, they are all contractible. Okay, so you are done. You know that the restriction of the tangent bundle to that is trivial. You know that the restriction to a tubular neighborhood is trivial. So you know that the tubular neighborhood is a parallelizable manifold. So you know that the Poincaré theorem applies. And then you can combine with the scaling, and you are done. So as a result of that, we got the following theorem, which is the fundamental result of the paper. So the second theorem, so this is like theorem one and theorem two. Theorem two, in fact, is more precise, as I will explain immediately. So theorem two is even more precise. What theorem two tells you is that let M be a four-spin manifold. Let M be, an oriented four-spin manifold. Spin manifold. Okay. Then the statement is that this set of degree y plus degree y prime, then for any integer n bigger or equal to 5, there exists, sorry, for any integer k bigger or equal to 5, there exist two maps y, y prime from M to the fourth sphere, okay, such that the form doesn't vanish, so y star of v plus y prime star of v different from zero everywhere for any x everywhere. Okay, and degree of y plus degree of y prime is equal to k. Okay, and how do you get this? How do you prove this result? You prove it by, you see the y prime which I constructed as degree zero, because of course it's contractible, okay? So it doesn't change the degree of y. So now you have to construct ramified covers, y, of the fourth sphere, which have a degree, which are ramified on a subset of codimension two, okay, which you want to be smooth, the map you want to be smooth, and you want the degree to be an arbitrary number bigger than 5. This has been done by Pierre Gallini, with Italian geometer, and I wrote to him to check, everything. And he constructed smooth such maps using the fact, for instance, that PL is equal to smooth in dimension 4. And he was able to make the singular set to be really non-singular. I mean, namely, it's a union of smooth surfaces, actually, in the four manifold. Okay? Okay, so that's what we get. That's what we get. Okay, and let me tell you what the geometers in Lyon proved. So, what they proved is actually quite remarkable. They proved that a necessary and sufficient condition for the existence of y and y prime is not W2 equals 0, but it's W2 squared is equal to 0. So W2 squared is equal to 0 is equivalent to there exists y, y prime. Ali, can you find their name in the paper? You have? Yeah, okay. Because I just keep going. So that, yeah, I mean. Ali does it, okay. Okay. No, no, they're not. I mean, they're not. I mean, in the case of, no, they're not. They're not. I mean, there is no. The fact that the neighborhood is parallelizable doesn't imply that they are orientable. No, but because the bundle is orientable anyway. So the bundle has a W1 which vanishes. So this you know from the start, because the bundle TM is orientable because the manifold is oriented. So you have no problem with W1. Your only problem is with W2. And W2 is, by the way, it's defined in cohomology mode 2. So it doesn't care if the manifold is oriented or not. It's cohomology mode 2. What? Bruno Sevenek and the other one? Yeah, okay, very good. So let me explain what they did because, it's in the converse, okay? So what they did is the following. It's a very interesting story. I had written to Etienne Gis. And then, he gave them the problem. Okay, and they found the necessary condition. Okay, what they found is the necessary condition. So this is the Sevenek, Bruno, and Jean-Claude Sikorov. They are both in Lyon. Okay, so let me explain what they did. Okay, so what they did, first, so they proved that, so if there exists y and y prime, then W2 square is equal to zero. And let me give you the proof. Proof is obvious. Why? Because you know you have two maps from the manifold to the sphere. The sphere has a stably trivial tangent bundle. So what you have a cover of M, whatever M is, okay, it is covered by two open sets. So like the complement of that one, okay. And in each of these open sets, the tangent bundle is trivial, is trivialized, okay? So then what you do is you, because the tangent bundle is trivialized there, the W2 for that vanishes, okay? And from that, you can immediately deduce, because it's covered by two open sets, that the square of W2 is zero, okay? Just by doing a little bit of Chech cohomology, okay? So you see that this condition is necessary. And of course, for projective space, this is what happens. W2 square is not equal to zero for projective space. Okay. So now, Bruno Sevenek is, I urged him to write a contrarian note, okay, to prove that, okay, so I could prove that if W2 is zero, it works, okay, because spin and all that. But he claims he can prove that if W2 square is zero, then it can go. And I urge him, of course, to write, you know, a contrarian note about this. And so I hope he will do it. Okay, very good. Okay, so now what I want to explain is the following. So now we are in the situation where, amazingly, the hypothesis which is true in physics, namely the fact that it's a spin manifold, suffices to find a solution to the equation. Moreover, there is more than that. Because when you find the solution to the equation with yy prime, okay, you get out of yy prime, you get a map from the manifold M to the product of two spheres, S4 cross S4. Okay? And with a little more effort, which we do in the paper, you can assume that this map from M to S4 cross S4 is transverse to itself, which means that it might have multiplicity, it might have self-intersection, but they are isolated points. So in other words, what happens, and what happens is the following picture, which is absolutely amazing picture, is that the manifold M now will emerge, okay, it will emerge from the product of two spheres okay so you will have two spheres of Planckian volume okay and the manifold M was folded inside so in other words you have this map yy prime which maps the manifold M to S4 cross S4, okay? But the manifold M itself has macroscopic volume, which can be arbitrary by this second theorem, okay? And, but somehow it is folded, okay? It's like, you know, folded many, many times inside the product of these two spheres. And this, of course, gives the idea that this is the way we should do quantum gravity. In other words, now what happens, so the next picture, if you want, from this, is the following. So the next picture is the following. The next picture is that we are now going to forget about manifolds and everything. We want to recover them from the quantum. And what do we do? Well, we write our equations, but we don't have to have a manifold. The manifold will appear. It will emerge, okay? So the equation will be really an equation between operators in Hilbert space. And it will be this kind of Heisenberg-type relation, okay? So the equation will be the following. You see, so we shall be given a Hilbert space. So this is no data. In that Hilbert space, we shall have an action of this Clifford algebra C plus plus C minus. This is no data. I put a plus here. Okay. So this will split the Hilbert space into, if you are familiar with this reconstruction of standard model, I mean, this will be like H for particles plus H for antiparticles. Okay, so it will split the Hilbert space into these two pieces. Okay, we shall have the J. The J is no data either, because it's unique. So far, I have specified nothing. The gamma, I am not taking the gamma of the standard model. I'm taking the gamma that commutes with C plus minus. So this is a reduced gamma, if you want. Okay, reduced gamma. Okay, so far, no structure at all. All of this is unique. Okay, and now I have two variables. So now I have two variables. Two variables. And these two variables are the Dirac operator D and the Y. And Y satisfies that its square decomposes into this. So if you want, it's like Y square is equal to 1 direct sum minus 1. This is the 1 in the space H particle. And this is the minus 1 in the space H antiparticle. Okay, and there is a J and so on. And the relation, if you want, with the previous, is that my Y now decomposes as Y plus plus Y minus. Okay, and the Y plus acting in H particle is what I was calling Y. So Y plus acts in H particle. Like y, okay, and y minus, sorry, j y minus j inverse acts in h plus h particle, like y prime. Okay, so this is the situation. Okay, this is the situation. Okay, so you write and so on. Okay, and you write the equation. But we have two variables now. Okay, we have two variables. Okay, and now comes the big thing. Big, big thing on which I am so happy that people have continued to work in non-commutative geometry. The big thing is the following. The big thing is that the following theorem, which I had written in my book, proved in my class, was written by Gracia Bondia and his collaborators in their book. And then was further and very improved by further work in non-commutative geometry. And the theorem, which is crucial now, is the following. It's a theorem which says the following. It says that for a spectral triple, which is, let us say, four summable, triple AHD, four summable, let's say four plus summable, the Hochschild class, of the Chern character in cohomology of the CH star is given by the Dixmier trace. Okay, it's given by the Dixmier trace. So it's the Dixmier trace integral. It's a four Hochschild cycle A0 up to A4, and up to normalization it's given by integral of gamma A0 dA1 dA4 times d to the minus 4. Okay, this is a quite hard result, very hard result, and I think, Alain, you worked on it. You improved the bound and so on. And in particular, the Dixmier trace is well defined in the sense that you don't have to ask. I mean, it's unique. It gives you a unique result. So this is very, very important. This is very, very. How does it come about? Well, this is what now in the setup of quantum gravity will give you the quantization of the volume. Okay, so let me explain. Let me explain how it comes about. So let me explain how it comes about. You see, there is something miraculous when you write the y, which is equal to y a gamma a. Okay, when you write a y like this, satisfying y squared equals 1, okay, as I said, you know, it gives you a projection e, which is 1 plus y over 2. Okay. But then there is something absolutely miraculous which happens, which is quite non-trivial, which is that when you write the chain character not in k-homology, but the chain character in k-theory, so ch upper star, if you want, of the projection e, okay, ch upper star of the projection e, it turns out, let me ignore the zeros component, it turns out that the lower components j for j equals 0, 2 of this vanish. They vanish. They are equal to 0. And the fourth component of the chain character in K theory, CH4 of E, is equal to, yes, it's equal formally, if you want, to y dy 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 with 4 dy's. Okay, that's the fourth component of the chain character, okay? But the lower components vanish. Now, the fact that the lower components vanish implies that when you pair with the k-homology fundamental class, you only care about the Hochschild class of the chain character. You don't care about the lower components, okay? So as a corollary of this result and of that one, okay, what you get is that for a y of this form, the index formula, the index of the Dirac operator with coefficient in E, okay, will be given up to normalization. So there is some normalization. Okay, it will be given up to normalization by integral, the Dixmier trace, of, sorry, I should have put here the brackets, because you have to take the trace with respect to the Clifford algebra. Okay, so it will be integral norm gamma y dy to the 4 d to the minus 4. Okay, that's what you get. Now, by the result with Ali and Slava, now we have two such y's, not one. Okay, so this implies, this result implies absolutely fundamental result. Okay, what does it imply? It implies that if we have the equations, if we have z dz the fourth equals gamma, okay, then we can compute, then we have, okay, let me compute. So, yes, okay, so then we have that integral, okay, so you have to watch if I don't make a mistake, okay. We have that, So I now compute integral like this, okay. So, no, sorry, I compute index of dE plus index of dE prime. Okay, I compute this. Okay, what is it? By this, it's given by integral of gamma y dy force d minus 4 plus same thing, integral gamma y prime dy prime, sorry, force d minus 4. Okay, but we know from the computations that we already did how to compute the sum of these two dy dy prime. We know that this sum here of the y dy 4, y prime 4 is equal to z dz 4. Okay, so this is equal to integral of gamma z dz 4 d minus 4. Okay. But this is equal to gamma. Gamma squared is 1. So what is this? This is integral of d to the minus 4. This is the leading term in the spectral action. That's the volume as defined in non-commutative geometry. So we get that the volume is quantized in this abstract framework. Okay? So we get that in this abstract framework, the volume is quantized. Second, we get that in this abstract framework, if you assume commutation of D as bounded commutators with Y and Y prime, I mean with the Y, you find out that the space that you have maps to four sphere times four sphere, but its image has Hausdorff dimension less or equal to 4. So it's carving a four-dimensional space inside of an eight-dimensional space. And the manifold begins to appear. And how the manifold appears, we write it very precisely in the paper. It's very subtle. Because what you have to do, you cannot say the manifold is generated by coordinates y and y prime. This would be wrong. You have to take the double commutant of y and y prime and then take those elements which are smooth there. In that way, you desingularize the singularities when there are self-intersections. Okay? So in fact, the general picture is the following. The general picture is out of this equation in dimension 4, geometry emerges. Okay? Geometry emerges. And it emerges coupled when you write the spectral action, okay, which you can, and you can write the inner fluctuations because you have the y and y prime. It emerges coupled with the standard model, I mean with the minimal asymptotically free extension of the standard model. Okay? So, Ali and Slava, they have written, you know, the candidate for the field theory, which is behind this. And what I have described to you, I mean, if you think more, you find out that these things are irreducible representations of the equation. Namely that if you look at the representation in Hilbert space, it turns out to be irreducible. And it's irreducible because you have the coordinates and you also have the Dirac operator and you cannot commute with everything, you know. So what we have found, if you want, like the Wigner picture of particles. Namely, what we have found is that there are quanta of geometry, and these quanta of geometry are incredibly close to what we see, you know, because what do we see? We see gravity coupled to standard model and so on. So the next step is, write down the field theory and so on. But maybe you can talk now, Ali. I know you are lazy, you know. Yes. Maybe you can give your talk this afternoon. You see? Ah, I knew you were lazy. Yeah. Well, you see, the idea is the following. The idea is that now what we have is a theory, what we have developed is a theory where you have two variables. The variables are the D and the Y, okay? And they satisfy some rules, algebraic rules. But the main rule is this equation, okay? Now, you would wonder, how can a manifold emerge from this? Because these are just operators, okay? So what do you do? Well, the Y is written as a sum of Y mu gamma, Y A gamma A, okay? So you have the Y A, okay? The Y A are self-adjoint operators. Similarly, the Y prime A are self-adjoint operators. So let me simplify and just take the algebras they generate. In fact, you have to be more careful. You have to take the von Neumann algebras they generate, and in that, take the smooth elements. But let's do that, okay? So what you have is you have an algebra which has a spectrum, okay, and which describes a space that normally would be eight-dimensional because you have the right number of coordinates. You have 8 degrees of freedom, okay? Okay, but in fact, it's not eight-dimensional because the commutation with the operator D to be bounded forces them to be of Hausdorff dimension 4. Okay? And how does it emerge in the classical case? In the classical case, there is a beautiful result which is due to Whitney, which tells you that every manifold of dimension n can be embedded not in R2n plus 1, in R2n. So in particular here, in S4 times S4. Okay? And so the manifold couldn't have emerged from a sphere or ramified cover, but it does emerge because you have exactly the right room. You have these two maps. Okay? And so now the idea is that it's out of operators that it emerges. What is the point of the manifold? It's an element in the spectrum of this algebra. What is the distance between two points? It's computed according to D. It's exactly the same story as with U inverse du is equal to 1. It's the same story. But the fantastic thing is that you know a priori that the volume is quantized, and you know a priori that any quantized volume bigger than 5 can arise. So you are ready for quantum gravity. I mean, you know, there is something that tells you that there is some operator equation that you can look at and whose irreducible representation produce for you what you expect to be for gravity. So I mean, as I said, you know, Ali and Slava have, on top of that, this is why I would like him to say something, but okay. You know. But I can try to say it for him, and he will stop me. But what they have found in the meantime, when we, you know, they have found that when you don't write the equation to hold, but when you write Lagrange multipliers for the equation to hold, you know, and you write the right field and so on, then you find out that you have a quantum field theory. Okay, and moreover, in this quantum field theory, they have appearance of what they called in previous papers, what they call mimetic matter. So in other words, not only you get standard model and so on, but you get a candidate for dark matter from what they do. So you know, I mean, and we have had now about 5 or 6 experiences with Ali, because we have a little bit the same temperament. We are ready to drop, you know, say, oh, okay, it doesn't work, and so on. But you know, we had enough now cases where we wanted to drop out. And in fact, you know, the model told us, no, I mean, you were wrong, you know, and this for this reason, that reason, and all that. It's always quite subtle. We don't claim to have the final answer or anything like that. But you know, we claim that gradually we shall get closer and closer to something which nobody can complain that it's disjoint from reality. You know, it's not like Calabia or whatever. I mean, you know, it's something you get there. I mean, you know, you get the right group, the right gauge group. You get everything you want. I mean, you know, it's not something. I mean, the big thing, really, in what I told you, besides the mathematics and so on, the big thing is that we got these two algebras, which we are not looking for. I mean, you know, we are not looking for them. We are looking for matrices and, you know, 4x4 matrices. And that. Nothing. Yes? Well, the relation is quite subtle because, you see, in physics, you don't expect that all the conditions which I put for the reconstruction theorem will actually be true, because they are technical conditions. So you don't expect that. And you probably expect to get perhaps manifold with some singularities or something like that. So here I am being very rough. I am saying if you want that, I mean, of course, there is a point in what you say in the sense that when I showed the reconstruction theorem, I was using what is called the orientability condition. That's a quantized form of the orientability condition. So the equation that we found is a quantized form of the orientability condition. Okay? And this is a big step. That's why it goes in the right direction for quantum gravity, because the orientability condition was like dealing with ordinary homology. But the quantized form deals with k-homology, which is much better, you know, because it has to do with the quantum. And the fact then that the volume is given by an index, by a sum of two indices actually, you know, this goes exactly in the right direction because it tells you that you are really in the quantum. I mean, you know, the fact that the volume is quantized is a fantastic thing because of this problem that we had with the cosmological term. And for instance, for the functional integral, what it tells you is that when you will do the functional integral, you will not have to worry about the cosmological constant, you know, about this cosmological term. So, you know, it's a big, big, big thing. I mean, this, for us, was a poof, big, big thing, you know, really. Yes, Fidele? Very
speaking, in all this construction, you need a quantity dimension of a length.
Sorry?
You need a quantity, the Planck length.
Exactly, yeah. Which is the inverse of, the Dirac, the inverse Dirac has dimension of a length. No, H bar is in the Dirac. H bar is in the formula for the Dirac operator.
H bar is in the Dirac when you connect the Dirac to the momentum.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, okay.
So
yeah.
H bar here will appear only when you do the action.
Yeah. Yeah,
so
yeah.
You're saying is that if you have a theory with a fundamental,
yes.
Or with a quantity,
yes. Yes.
Then you can construct
something macroscopic. Something macroscopic. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, okay, okay, yes.
So what you are doing here is you are in a condition in which the Planck length
yes.
is non-zero.
Yeah, yeah, if you want.
But you could do the whole thing classically.
Yeah, no, no, okay, sure. Without a, no, okay, but the H-bar, I think, will happen in the next step, which we are doing now, which is to relate to cosmology. And the relation with cosmology, I don't want to give it out. But if you want... There will be something where which will play the role of what you're saying. Yeah, yeah, sure. Of course. So there it will occur, definitely. Yes. There was one thing which I forgot to say, which I put in the blog, you know, non-commutative geometry, but which is quite, and which I put at the end of the paper also, which is very important. It's very important to have a mental picture now of what is going on. And one mental picture is the following, is that, you know, it's very surprising, this relates to your question, why space-time is macroscopic. Because when you write any type of equation in physics, you find something which has a Planck size, you know. And the idea is the following. The idea is that eventually when we do cosmology, the picture that emerges is that it's like, you know, the manifold M. It's like a butterfly which is being folded in the product of these two spheres of quantum size. But itself, it has macroscopic size, and it unfolds. And one amazing thing is that when you write down these maps, the sphere, you know, with the degree and all that, you find that there are natural operations in mathematics which are coming from self-maps of the sphere. Now, what is the effect of these operations on the butterfly? It multiplies its volume by a constant. It's not that it adds. It multiplies the volume by a constant k. And of course, this is extremely reminiscent of the e-folding in inflation. So, you know, this is something which we have not done, but it really suggests that this picture, you know, where the volume is quantized and is related to the degree of maps and so on, has a lot of potential, you know, has enormous potential for explaining this business, you know, of the size of the universe in Planck units and all sorts of things. But there are plenty of, you know, fundamental questions which have to be asked. I mean, for instance, when you write the Heisenberg relation, you put h-bar. So, you know, one has to put the constants where they should be and all that, of course. I mean, this is, of course, very, very important. I mean. But, I mean, I have a good you know, help from physicists. So, I mean, you know, I don't mind that. I mean, there is no problem.
Yes.
No, there are no wormholes. I mean, you know, what the thing is, not yet there, not yet in that state, you know. No, I mean, the thing is folded. You see, what I mean is that what you can prove, actually, and we prove this in the paper, is that you can actually find an immersion in S4 cross S4, immersion which is transverse to itself. What does it mean? It means that, okay, it's not yet an embedding. In fact, Sevenek is working on the problem. That's why he didn't yet write the thing of finding an embedding. But, I mean, even if it's not an embedding, it has crossing. It has self-crossing, but they are important because, you know, they are totally transverse. You just cross in one point. So this is, sorry? They are there, but I mean, they are very simple type of singularities, if you want, which Whitney was able to get rid of. But of course, to get rid of them and still satisfy the condition, it's a very, very. Well, I don't know. I mean, the link with cosmology, it will come later. But I think, you know, that what I have explained today, what we have done in this work, is the culmination of many, many years where, for instance, Gianni wrote a book, you know, Raising a Quantum Baby, you know, and all that. I mean, so the whole point of this story is the following, is that if you really understand quantum mechanics, you know that when you make experiments in a lab and so on, you'll find the two sphere as being the spin occurring in experiments and complex numbers and all that. They are there. The inverse space is in front of you. You cannot just rule it out. You know, it's just there. So the idea is that either we think of reality from classical frameworks, and then we become geometers, and we do a lot of things, or we believe that reality is born from the quantum, which is a completely different philosophy. But then we have to have a scenario of how our reality, which we see in a macroscopic manner, classically and all that, is actually born from the quantum. And this is it. This is it. This is really the place where you can have good hopes, you know. And it's in the line of Heisenberg. I mean, it's not in the line of string theory or whatever. You know, it's in the line of Heisenberg. It's an extremely simple quantum mechanical type equation, okay, from which, with operator theory, with a lot of stuff, so the manifold can emerge, but it emerges not naked. It emerges with a slash of the coordinates, which brings together the standard model. You know. Yeah. That's the idea. Yeah. No, no, no. I mean, you, there you don't look at the geometry. It's a volume. It's a volume story. It's a volume story. You see. Folding is a volume story. But Ali knows a lot more, and I feel, you know. But on the other hand, I feel I couldn't stop before. You know, yeah. I couldn't stop before because I had to explain this.